Welcome to Free Media, Free Minds. Free Media, Free Minds is a program that explores media freedom, diversity, and access to information. My name is Phumeza Mtegazi.
And I'm Helga Jansen Daubia. You and I, South Africans, consume media in different ways, for information, but also for entertainment. The dominant television and radio outlets are owned by the state via the South African Broadcasting Corporation. Interestingly enough, four very powerful private corporations own the newspapers and some of the community newspapers. In our show, we discuss media ownership and control. We ask, what is the agenda of the state and these four powerful corporations? How does it influence editorial freedom? And most importantly, how does it affect your, my, and our right to know? Don't go away.
Joining us in studio is a journalist and editor in radio, Mr. Zenzile Khoisan. Welcome, Zenzile.
Thank you.
And a journalist and editor at Workers World Media Productions, Zee Velapi. Welcome, Zee.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
And editor of Amandla magazine, Mr. Ben Fogel. Welcome, Ben.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you to all of you. Before we launch into our discussion on media ownership and control, let's watch a clip produced by the Workers World Media Productions and the Alternate Information Development Center called False Prophets.
It has affected, you know, number of companies, this economic crisis. We got companies here that have closed, and we got workers or companies that have subjected workers on perpetual short times and layoffs. And many workers have been retrenched. They lost their own jobs.
It was not me alone who was subjected into these work cuts, you know. It made me to feel firstly, insecure. Secondly, you know, it demoralized me in one way or another, because when I sit at home and look at my kids, you know, I could see that there's a problem here. And even that fatherhood, you know, mood was not there at all times.
The people who are paying for the crisis are not the capitalists, because they are getting bailed out. The banks have been bailed out. That money is going to have to be found from somewhere, and it's workers who will pay for this crisis, although it's not of their doing.
Comrades, over the past 5 years, all the construction companies have been making profits, which runs into 999%. We know that they don't feel no recession. The only people who feel a recession is the workers.
One person who is employed by any company is supporting not less than 10 family members.
Viva Cosatu, viva!
Viva!
Viva Cosatu, viva!
Viva!
I did work here for 6 years and was retrenched.
It was the saddest day on last year, but I have to take the retrenchment because there was no other way.
It's hard if you're not working and you're unemployed to put food on the table with the prices increased nowadays. And for me as a mother and to look after my parents as well, I struggle a bit at home.
You have kids, they are using transport, and when they are going to school in the morning, they wake you up, mommy, where's the bus fare? Where are you going to say, where is the bus fare? Not earning nothing.
Petrol prices are very much, you know, unbearable in these days, because it is rising every year.
The train prices were increased, taxis, a bus, you know, even water, they are increasing now, the electricity were increasing.
I had to rent out my house even to actually, you know, survive, because I had to move back to my parents, because where am I going to get the money from to actually pay the bond?
When there's nothing in the house and they're suffering, the girls think the only way to help our parents or our grannies is to go out for prostitution. Nowadays they don't even worry if they get money, just as long as they get a bag of food just to bring home. then they sell their bodies for that. That's what the young girls do nowadays.
There's very little sign of relief for the already bad conditions, and they're likely to get worse in the coming period.
The executive of WBHO gave himself a 55% increase. 57 million in 2008. Now, comrades, what is 13% on poverty wages?
There's only been one class victim of that reconciliation, and that's the working class. All the others have gained. They've moved out of the townships, they've moved into the suburbs, they got better jobs, some have become capitalist, etc. Whereas the working class doesn't have the option to escape. It lives out its class condition.
There was a clip of the documentary False Prophets made by the Workers World Media Productions and the Alternative Information and Development Center.
Sensile, let's start with you. We saw from the clip that the overriding motivation of the system in which we live is to increase profits. And take us through how this motivation to increase profits affects how media plays out in our lives.
Well, when we're dealing with media, and if you do a cursory review of most of the media, if you do an audio edit, an audio survey of what's on the airwaves at the moment, if you do a survey of what's on the television at the moment, if you look at what's in the major print and electronic media, you find that there are two things that come through. One, there is an overriding agenda to force people to accept a manufactured consensus.
Okay, before you continue, explain this, especially to our viewers at home. Manufactured consensus.
A manufactured consensus. You see, it is often said that the ruling ideas, the predominant ideas in every period, are the ideas of the ruling cliques. Now, who are these ruling cliques? These ruling cliques are, on the one hand, the corporations that you refer to. You refer to in the independent group, Caxton, Avusa, Naspers. It's a very powerful financial entities that don't have only vested interest in the media, but are invested across the entire military-industrial complex. In other words, they have interest in farming, in agriculture, they have interest in mining. They literally control the entire economic space. So the media aspect of that is the end game of the control of that space. The second part of it is that you find the state corporation. Now, on the side of the state, we have a compromiso historico that brought us to the so-called democracy that we're living in. But we have a broadcasting institution that's supposed to be a public broadcaster. But then you find the confluence between the agenda of the predominant party, the ruling party, and this notion of having a public media space. So that public media space has become almost like a state ruling party space where the predominant ideas of the ruling party are being driven through, literally drilled through the population using the state media, which is institutions that are supported by our tax dollars.
Now, Ben, if I may come to you. Can you tell us more on how do the media owners practice censorship?
Well, I mean, often it's not even explicit censorship. What happens is there's a specific editorial direction set, which is somewhat influenced by the owners. And it's not really so much censorship as it's what stories are shown, what stories are given the space, and what limits to the debate are constructed within the media. For example, you often get there's two sides to every story, and on one side it's basically the opposition party or the ANC, which are arguing about very superficial issues. We're against corruption. We also are against corruption, but you guys are corrupt. So it's not really exactly, I would say, almost always explicit censorship. It's often that there are limits to what every story can get.
You say we. Who's we?
In terms of we, it's also basically the media is a class in itself, in some sense. The old term is a fourth estate. There is a class of pundits, journalists, media operators, editors, and it's almost interchangeable routine of people who dominate the airwaves, dominate the print. It's, there's this set of voices which offer given the time.
Mzi, I see you wanted to come in here.
Yes, yes. Ben is right. They do not do it explicitly, but what they do is censorship by omission. They just marginalize and pretend things are not there.
I like this term, censorship by omission. Give us an example of the censorship by omission.
Okay, for example, I mean, in the short clip that we watched, we've seen workers talking about their conditions and their living and working conditions. That's not the kind of stuff that you'll see in mainstream media. They do not talk about those things. The only time you'll hear about workers' issues or community issues is when communities or workers protest. And that's the only time that you're gonna hear their side of the story. Even that, it gets to a point where, for example, if it's a protest or it's a strike, I mean, you will see workers toying on the street, and then they will interview a union leader or two or three protesters, and immediately cut into someone sitting in an office, some expert or some corporation, someone sitting in an office. And as a viewer, who do you take seriously in that context? Who gets to make sense to you sitting at home?
Yes,
because it's going to be the guy sitting in an office, calm, he knows what he's talking about.
Explain to us, based on the example and the discussion that MZ was having, the power of these corporations, including the state, in helping to shape our perceptions of what is normal. MZ spoke about, we have a clip of toy-toying workers, and then immediately we cut to an official-looking person in a suit. And that's the last image that we're left with. Just talk us through this power to change the perceptions of who we are.
Well, there are two maxims that drive the major print and electronic media, and that is the space that has been monopolized. And the one is all the news that's fit to print or air. The other one is if it burns or bleeds, it leads. What does that mean? It means that you have a consensus of the controllers, a consensus about a perspective that has to be authored. In other words, if South Africa is going in the direction where they have to deal with the, quote, liberalization of the economy, they have to deal with the fact of removing exchange controls, removing institutions that limit the ability of corporates to literally smash and create, for instance, a bloodbath of jobs, a million jobs, then that becomes the dominant discourse that they eat out. So if you look at the newspapers, if you look at the Argus, the Burger, the Sunday Times, if you go through ETV, SABC 1, SABC 2, SABC 3, if you even go into the new area, the digital environment, you will find that there is a consensus about what is right. So in other words, what is right is that the country is going into a neoliberal direction. So all policies that are attenuated to that cause are considered right. So they drag out all what they call the experts. And these experts articulate that point of view. And across the board, in the other side of it...
Before you continue, let's bring Ben in here, because I like this thing about experts. Ben, you with Amandla Media, you're the editor of Amandla Magazine, also part of a collective called Africa is a Country. Mm. How do you, in your work, try to change the perception of who the expert is? Because we're all familiar with the usual experts on economics, on politics, on gender, on the way that we see our country even. So how do you make sure that you bring in an alternate voice?
Well, I think we first need to define what expert is. Expert is actually a ideological category. In fact, expert is basically promoted in place of the intellectual. An expert is somebody who's proficient in either technocratic knowledge, the person who can comment, and who can comment in a sort of pseudo-scientific way, the political analyst, the economist, the person from the analyst from Goldman Sachs. These are very specific people. They're very from a very specific class.
So when we have these analysts, we already create a distance between the people who consume the information and the people who generate the information?
Yeah, I mean, an expert exists to give a certain opinion. It's basically Dal quote.
So in your work, how do you create a different understanding of expert?
Well, I would say the expert isn't the contested terrain. What the contested terrain is, one, is to attack the concept of expert in itself. It's that the person who's sitting in the office has the sort of expertise because they've trained at the so-and-so university, but can speak on behalf of other people. Who
Again, Ben, I have to ask you, in your work...
I'm getting specific. I think the goal is not to challenge the conception of expert, it's to critique it. I think in my work, and a lot of what I do, is to attack the concept of expert to show how vacuous these concepts and often this analysis is. I don't think necessarily we should be promoting our own experts in their place. We should be rather testing, these are people's voices. We should be opening up another space in which can be contested rather than saying, these are these economists and we need to go and like bring our own in necessarily.
I think what you need to do is, you know, all the news that's fit to print or air, for instance, the stories that don't get told are the stories that have to do with the actual life and life experience of the majority of the people. The kind of experience we don't find is the viewpoint of the people who actually, as Bob Marley says, who feels it, knows it. The one who feels doesn't get represented in the media. Your feeling, what you're going through, your experience is not properly articulated. On the other side, there's this sensationalism.
Why is that person not represented?
He's not represented because you have a controlling group. We began this discussion by saying the predominant ideas in every period are those of people who rule, who control. And the space is controlled not by a bunch of editors, but it's actually controlled by the people who are at the apex of a military-industrial complex. The industrial overlords make decisions that fit their agenda. And on the other hand, they keep the people, like in the Roman times, they keep the people in this kind of bread and circuses world where, for instance, they sensationalize the news. So what you have is a people that a reading and a media consuming populace that is being battered by an agenda that is thoroughly embedded in every aspect of life.
I think the other source of that consensus that he's talking about is the in the newsroom. Yeah. Like is the whole the values that get attached to news. What constitutes news? What makes news? He said, if it bleeds, it leads. For example, if people in Khayelitsha block N2 because they want proper sanitation, proper housing, that gets to be reported that these people are a nuisance, these people are problematic. But the media will never ever go to Khayelitsha every day and record and talk to people about the store their everyday kind of life, everyday story.
Is that the kind
which
of...
is not having a proper toilet. You know how demeaning is that? I mean, the other day I was taking a bus home, I mean, along the N2 next to Nyanga. I saw this woman, she was sitting on the side of the road, relieving herself. I mean, she's a woman. I mean, anything could have happened to her. But those are not the kind of stories that you get in mainstream media. It's really pathetic.
Yeah. Ben, come in here. I see you.
Yeah. Sorry. I just want to make two quick points. Yeah. One, it's very clear as well, is that the way that people don't actually do it consciously when they're in the newsroom. It's the way they've been trained as journalists.
Sure.
It's the way they've gone through an internship. You're taught you need to speak to these people to get this story.
Yeah.
An expert opinion is more newsworthy than the other thing. But I think we need to bring in this point. We can't speak of media as such a monolithic category for one reason. Currently is that media's in crisis. They haven't figured a way to make money out of the internet. Mm. All these newspapers are losing circulation rapidly. They're all trying to find new ways of trying to make money, trying to increase advertising, getting content from other sources, cutting down newsrooms.
All that thought. I like that thought about they are losing profits and they have to find new ways of making these profits. They haven't quite figured that one out. Hold that thought. When we're back, we're going to talk media ownership and control. Don't go away.
Thank you.
with Free Media, Free Minds, and we're discussing media ownership and control in South Africa and its impact on editorial and audience. Now, while we're on break, Benny brought up very important points. Can you let our viewers know about them?
Well, I mean, the point I was making before is that even in terms of profitability, especially print media is in severe crisis. With the advent of the internet and free content online, they've lost a lot of circulation, and people haven't really figured out how to make money off the internet. Advertising doesn't quite pay the bills. And furthermore, what you've also seen, because the way that the owners of the media see it is that you always have to increase profitability, you can't maintain. So you need to always break into new audiences. For example, City Press has been under sort of restructuring under Fareel Hafaji to break into sort of historically white markets. They call it non-racial, but that's really what it is. And what the consequence of that and this drive for profitability is you alienate your original audience, which is black middle-class people who don't really like this new direction, and they lose circulation. Or you see a real dumbing down of content because people have this idea that the more page views you get, the more advertisers you get, the more money you get. So you have sort of hysterical celebrity gossip. You have sort of inane BuzzFeed type content in serious publications in search of cheap clicks.
What is BuzzFeed?
BuzzFeed is the sort of a website which amalgamates content which has like seven sins of a celebrity or just random lists. And the Mail and Guardian will be copying that because the people who are in charge of it now.
And it's quite sad, Ben, because these, historically, the City Press and the Mail and Guardian have been bastions of analysis of what's been happening in our society. And now you're saying they're going to be telling us the seven sins of Kanye or whoever.
Yeah, I mean, what's really happening is that a bunch of Media 24 people are now running Mail and Guardian, and it's really sort of a new generation who have been brought up in the sort of model of quick, easy content, which is cheaper to produce. You don't even have to go outside the office, let alone make a phone call. You just need to Google. It's much cheaper than sending people out in the field.
So this is really dumbing down.
It's a real dumbing down because they think they can get more money that way, but in the end, they're going to be screwing themselves over because the old people who have been reading the newspaper, the original audience, be like, whoa, I don't want this. And my generation doesn't really buy newspapers. I mean, I just want to make one final point. If you want to see an example of how a story is constructed in terms of a newsroom as an unconscious decision, corruption stories are sort of the model of investigative journalism in this country. It really involves around state or public sector corruption and shenanigans from Nkantla to whatever Gates the media decides needs the story. But at the same time, the private sector is not reported on the same way. There's not the same amount of critical coverage or investigation into price-fixing cartels. And the scale of corruption, if you would like to use that term, in the private sector is enormous. I mean, Construction Gate, which is essentially price-fixing and scamming the taxpayer out of about 50 billion rand for massive construction deals for the World Cup, that's far bigger than anything in the public sector. But the reason why, I mean, if you want to make a sort of reductionist approach, is that the same people who own these corporations, particularly NASPERS, have interests in all these other businesses.
So this is the power paradigm that Zenzile was sketching for us earlier, that they are pervasive, they are everywhere, and they literally shape how we see ourselves in every particular way.
We have to come back to the whole question of dumbing down. And here I want to focus, for instance, on what's happening with the public broadcaster. The public broadcaster, the first signs of what I would have seen as danger signals was when you had the pruning of who has the right to comment, taking out people like Moletsi Mbeke, who is a critical mind, the removing of serious and senior probing journalists like Nikiwe Bekicha, John Perlman. There is, in my, I've been a journalist for 30 years. I've worked in corporate media, and I've worked in the community or alternative sector. And what I've seen is that there's the juniorization of the newsroom. There is a complete lack of training in people who purvey the news. The news is seen as a stepping stone to some kind of glamorous position in life, rather than what we're supposed to do, which is to bring news with fairness and accuracy in the reporting, to be able to probe down, drill down, dig up, feed up the information into...
Now, is that why you're still doing this after so many years?
Well, you know, I mean, today I run a newspaper called Eastern Asinis. I'm the editor of that. What you look at in that 22,000 metric centimeters of copy is all the news that you won't find in the major print and electronic media of a major phenomenon that's hitting South Africa. There are two bills pending before Parliament. The bill around land restitution to accommodate the Khoisan, and number two, the one, the traditional affairs bill, the TRAD bill. These two bills deal with the fact that an entire populace who have been considered or classified as colored during colonialism and apartheid are now found in the space. There's been an entire identity movement that has happened over the last 20 years in this country, and this has been completely invisible in the major print and electronic space. So what we have to do is to interject this into the space with our own newspaper.
I want to just remind our viewers and you that we're going to see you again in the second part of our show. So we want you to continue that thought. But I do want to ask Mzee before before we wrap up, that you are working in Alternative Media Workers World Media Productions. Zinzile and Ben, both of you know that we have more than 150 community stations across the country. And that legislatively, our right to access media, to produce media, is entrenched in our constitution. But the way that all three of you describe the state of control of media paints a different picture. Mzee, why is this? It's guaranteed in our constitution.
Okay. First of all, community media in this country is underfunded. And also in the sense that, they are very small newsrooms. In fact, what they do, like in most community radio stations, they lift stories from SABC, IOL, and then they run with those stories. So number one is the issue of human resource. And secondly, it's also the issue of not having money to run the station and pay people to come and produce decent programs. But as the organization, as a labor media organization, we have partnering with about 50 community radio stations in South Africa. We produce a weekly labor radio show that broadcasts on these stations, and it's in five languages. And it's based on workers' stories. We're telling workers' stories, and the radio stations run with those stories. So it's part of us coming in and capacitating the community radio station, but in a partnership kind of a way.
Clearly it seems like there's lots of work to be done around arresting the control back. But I want to ask each of you in 10 seconds to tell us still why you do, and I think Pumeza alluded to this, why you continue doing the work that you do when the task seems enormous, insurmountable almost. Ben, starting with you.
One.
Very short.
To be honest, being in media is fun, and secondly, it's a contested terrain, and even though it seems almost monolithic, there's spaces, even in the mainstream, to get stories out there and to compete in the debate. And if somebody else isn't, if I'm not doing it, who else is?
See?
I'm doing it because I believe in justice, and also I love my people. And the fact that, we live in an inequal world, and my people are the ones who are bearing the brunt of this, so that's why I'm doing it.
I believe the majority have an IQ that's way above room temperature, and this does not include the rotten politicians, the really the disgusting bankers, and the real estate, and that whole coalition of people who have literally divested our people, the majority of the people, their right to know.
So there you have it. The right to know is a continuous battle, a continuous struggle that we must never let go of. Our constitution guarantees that we can own and control the media. Till next time, you're watching Free Media, Free Minds. I'm Helga Janssen.
And I'm Pumeza Mtegazi. Till we meet again on Free Media, Free Minds.
I have changed the idea of a human rights.